Okay, so I will talk now about the neutrino masses and the oscillations, which are a very broad topic that will be in many talks in this conference also. Again, trying to be talking to the students. You know, in the standard model, the masses of the fermions arise essentially from the Yukawa couplings that couple left-handed fields with right-handed fields with a double of Higgs bosons. And when the Higgs gets a wave in the neutral component, you end up with these mass terms mixing left and right, and the masses are just the wave of the Higgs and the Yukawa coupling. And then, usually, well, one writes the Lagrangian in terms of the flavor or Eigen states, which are those that appear, for instance, the charge current when you have an up coupling to a down with a W. These are flavored Eigen states. And so in each family, up coupling to the down, strange to charm, and top to bottom. But these are not mass Eigen states, in principle, the states in which you write this Lagrangian. And you have to change to the basis of the mass Eigen states, making unitary rotation of these fields. Both in the up and down sectors, rotating both the left and the right, so as to make this Yukawa coupling diagonal. So you do this with this transformation, where you go to the mass Eigen states, and when you write down the charge current that was very simple diagonal in the flavor Eigen state, you write it in the mass Eigen state basis, you get up with a mixing matrix, which is the Kawio-Kobayashi-Maskawa matrix, which is just the product. This involves only left-handed fields, so you only have the rotation of the left-handed fields, both in the up and in the down, multiplied. And so if you want to see, look at the coupling of a given mass Eigen state to another mass Eigen state, you have a mixing of all the three generations. And usually, the convention that people adopt is that before doing all this, it's convenient to go to a basis to choose the flavoring state basis such that the uptide quarks coincide with the mass Eigen states. And so if you there is an arbitrarity where you put the rotations, you can start with a basis in which the uptide quarks are the mass Eigen states and these are flavoring states, and then the mixing will appear in the down sector when you do that. And so the down mass Eigen state will be a mixture of the flavor down the Eigen states in this way. And you can use different processes involving different transition from involving different families, and you can measure the different mixing angles by all these processes. And you end up with the Kawio-Kobayashi-Maskawa, which is essentially one in the diagonal, you see. Then has the Kawio mixing appearing in the downstream sector, and then the other mixing are very small. You know that the charge fermion, like the quarks I was discussing here, involves 4 degrees of freedom. There are left and right, for instance, for the electron, you have electron left, electron right, you have the positron left and positron right. So particles and antiparticles, left and right, and they are related by parity, charge, or CP. And an important field is that you consider like Weyl fields, the left-handed field here for the particle of left chirality, the antiparticle with right-handed chirality, essentially the conjugate of this field, in this definition of the conjugation. And so these two fields, are related by CP, and these other two fields are related by CP, and they contain 2 degrees of freedom each. Going now to the neutrinos, if we want to give neutrino masses, the simplest thing will be to repeat the same story for the neutrinos. So one could introduce a right-handed neutrino. In principle, this particle has a right-handed neutrino is a singlet of SU2, so it has no weak interaction. It's neutral, has no electromagnetic, has no strong, it's sterile for all the purposes, and so is a particle that you cannot produce by gauge interaction, you cannot detect by gauge interaction, but you can put it in the Yukawa and try to give a mass term to the neutrinos in the same way you did for the quarks. And in this case, you get the Dirac mass, which appears as the product of Yukawa and the wave of the Higgs doublet. Here, the convention is that you take the flavoring state so that the charged fermions, charged leptons, are the mass eigenstates are the flavoring states. And so the mixing appears in the neutrino sector. I repeat, this is a convention. One could, in principle, do the other way around, but it is natural, and since we measure the masses of the leptons, we take this as defining the flavoring states, because we can measure when an electron is produced, we know that the nu is produced. But this nu will be a mixture of Meissen states. So the mixture appears here in the neutrino sector, and you can diagonalize the mass matrix and end up with a given set of mass eigenstates with different masses. You can define a Dirac field with 4 degrees of freedom with the left and the right-handed components of the neutrinos. Each one of those have 2 degrees of freedom. And when you write the charge current of the leptons, so a neutrino coupling to a lepton, in you go to the mass eigenstate basis, you will have this equivalent of the CKM is the Pontecorvo Maki Nakagawa Sakata matrix, which is a mixing in the neutrino sector, which essentially comes from the left-handed rotation you had to do with these fields there. So Pontecorvo is the equivalent of Cavivo, and the Japanese are the equivalent to the other Japanese. And now you have the same picture of what are the degrees of freedom when you have this Dirac neutrino. But the problem is that we know that neutrino masses are very small. No? I told you before that they were below around 0.1 electron volt. And this vacuum expectation value here, V is 250 GeV. So you have to go from 200 GeV to 10 to the minus 1 electron volt. So you have more than 11 orders of magnitude, the difference. And so the Yukawa has to be smaller than 10 to the minus 11 to give the masses such a small values. And this is not appealing. So people don't like this idea of having to introduce by hand such a small coupling. And so the idea is to try to see if we can do it differently to give neutrinos a mass. And in this picture of the 4 degrees of freedom, the 2 degrees of freedom we know that exist are these two. So for instance, when there is a beta plus decay, emission of a positron and neutrino, this is this guy, the left-handed neutrino, which is active. And in a beta minus decay, you have the anti-neutrino right, which is produced, which is this guy. So these two have to be there. We know they are there. The other two are those that we wanted to introduce by hand in the previous example. But it's not really required by any phenomenology. So can we give neutrino masses just with these two states without introducing these other two? And the answer is in principle yes, but not in the standard model as the minimal standard model that we have. So if you don't introduce this guy and you only have his doublets, you cannot give neutrinos a non-zero mass. And so in principle, you need to go beyond the standard model. And there are different approaches to go beyond that. This is a more or less technical equation, but slide. But this conjugate field that was the antiparticle field is proportional to the conjugate of the field, so it has all the opposite charges that the field has, no? And this conjugation matrix C is a unitary matrix that has to satisfy some relations with the gamma matrices in order to make that this field transform in the same way as in Lorentz transformation as the field psi. You remember that the mass term always mixes a left-handed field with a right-handed field. And so the way one could give a mass term to the neutrinos, just using these 2 degrees of freedom present in psi left, would be to make this combination where you take the conjugate field, which is a right-handed field, as you see here, and couple it to the left-handed field, and the same in this way. Given that psi has the opposite charges of say conjugate, this relation which has a bar here and a conjugate there has two charges of lepton number. So in principle, this, if I were to rotate this PL by a phase, this phase will appear, will not cancel between the two. It's not like in the Dirac mass matrix where one can give different rotation to left and right and make a symmetry. But here, this interaction violates lepton number by two units. But it has the correct left to right transition, involves just 2 degrees of freedom, and this is what is called the Majorana mass term. It was introduced by Majorana at the 37, I think, 38. He was worried with another thing, was he was worried with, you know, this idea of the, when you have the Dirac equation, you have all these energy, negative energy states that people used to feel them and just study the excitation from this sea of fermions in the universe. And he didn't like that, and so he tried to make a theory that was symmetric between particles and antiparticles and end up with this conclusion that it could be that there are just two neutrinos and they have a mass in this way. And you cannot do this for charged particles because you will violate charge conservation. And so if you want to give neutrinos a Majorana mass in a more elegant way, like we did with the usual fermions through the Higgs mechanism, so through the wave of a scalar field, you can do it, for instance, from this coupling where you have the lepton doublet, and you take a triplet of Higgs fields. This combination is Lorentz invariant. These are the three sigma matrices, the Pauli matrices. And you can see that when you give a mass wave to this neutral component, you end up with a mass for the neutrinos, which is just the Yukawa involved here and the wave of the Higgs. In principle, if you have decided to also add a singlet, a neutrino, you can do the same thing. Give a, with these 2 degrees of freedom of Enright, give a mass to a singlet neutrino, introducing a coupling to a scalar field S. These are all singlets of SU2, so this will be a singlet of SU2, and the mass will be the Yukawa times the wave of the scalar. And so in principle, in the most general situation where you introduce a right-handed field and you allow for Majorana masses, you end up with a 2x2 matrix, having the triplet mass, the Dirac mass, coupling left to right, and the heavy Majorana mass, coupling right to right. And in particular, this is what gives rise to the CISO mechanism. CISO is this thing, I don't know how you call it in Portuguese. Subibaja, we say in Spanish, but okay. So the idea is that the simplest case where you put the triple mass to zero and you take a very large singlet mass, because this singlet is a field that has no relation to SU2 breaking, so it can be related to a grand unification breaking, so it has no relation to the width scale, so it could be very heavy. And if this happens, you put this to zero and you diagonalize this matrix, you will end up with a mass which is md squared divided by m, essentially. And so, and this will be the light states, and that there will be heavy states with mass proportional to m. This, in principle, could be each of these could be 3x3 if you are in three generations, and you introduce three right-handed neutrinos. But the idea is that the heaviest you put the mass of the single state, the lowest becomes the mass of the light state, because the mass of the light guy is md over m times md. This is about the weak scale, 100 GeV, and this could be very small. And so this is gives an explanation why neutrino masses are so much lighter than the other masses, because the other masses are at the scale of the weak interactions, and this one is suppressed by the ratio of weak to the heavy scale. For instance, if you want to get 0.1 electron volt for the mass of a neutrino, and you take these masses in the order of the 1 to 100 GeV, this scale will be between 10 to the 10 and 10 to the 14 GeV. So it will be kind of, this mass here could be the Yukawa times the scale of the wave of this Higgs. That could be 10 to the 16 if you want GeV. There are, well, this is another way of viewing this si saw mechanism, the neutrino Majorana mass coupling nu L to nu LC come from the coupling of the Dirac coupling of nu L with nu R, then the singlet mass of the heavy guy that violates lepton number, and then this coupling again with the doublet Higgs and gives you this. And there are variants of this. This is what is called type 1 CISO, where you have the exchange of the heavy neutrino and the two Higgs is taking waves. You could also couple this left-hand field to a triplet, and then the triplet to two Higgs doublet. And if you include this, this will give you a mass term for the left-handed neutrinos. Or you could also exchange here, not a singlet like here, but you can exchange the triplet Higgs, triplet of SU2, that couples to the Higgs doublets. And this is another way, it's called type 3 CISO. And in general, all these mechanisms are described by what is called a Weinberg operator, which has two lepton fields and two Higgs fields, coupled in this way. This is dimension 5, because you have two fermions, 3/2 each one, and two scalars contributing to one. Each one, so and so here you need a suppression by a heavy scale, which will be the mass of this guy or that guy or that guy. So there are other ways to generate neutrino masses. They can come from loop effects where the masses are small because they are suppressed by a loop factor. They may come from effects of extra dimensions, or there are many ways in which you can give the masses, but I would say that this one is the nicest one, the simplest one. Because in many series like SO10, you have for free these right-handed neutrinos, they are heavy naturally, and they are there. So now coming to the mixing, like in the quark sector, this matrix is decomposed in general into different rotations, three rotations, angle 2-3, 1-3, and 1-2, depending on which sector you rotate. And you can introduce a phase here, which is the equivalent of the CKM phase, violating CP. And then in general, if you have Majorana neutrinos, you will have two other phases, which are called Majorana CP violating phases. If the neutrinos were Dirac, you can remove these phases as you do with the quarks, and they will not appear. But otherwise, they appear. And they appear in some processes like double beta decay. And so they're in principle relevant. And so when you make this product of the different mixing angles, here you have more or less the values we know today that are relevant for each of the mixings. The atmospheric is almost maximal. Solar is, the 1-2 is around 34 degrees, and the 1-3 mixing is around 8 degrees. And you have your matrix there, parameterized and ready to be used. The bounds on neutrino masses come from different places. One which is very important is to look at the spectrum of the beta decay. Remember, the spectrum of the beta decay was continuous for the energy of the electron. And if the maximum energy is in principle the available energy you have from the decay, it has to do with the masses of the initial final nucleus and the mass of the electron, but if the neutrino has a mass, the energy of the electron cannot be at the maximum level because the neutrino is taking always at least its mass in energy, and so the energy of the electron will be reduced. Usually the spectrum distribution of the electron energy is given by the sum over the possibility of meeting the three mass eigenstates of the neutrinos with couplings EI square, which is because you are producing an electron neutrino, which is a mixture of three mass eigenstates. And the distribution for a given mass is given here, has a phase space factor, a Coulomb factor correction, and essentially depends on the neutrino mass through this term here, appearing here. Usually one doesn't plot this ratio, one plots the Curie function, which is this ratio, this distribution divided by the phase space of the electron, essentially. And essentially is the phase space of the neutrino normalized and should be something like, you see, if the neutrino mass is not there, you have this is Q minus E. So it should be like that, a straight line. And if you put given neutrinos mass, what will happen is that at the end it will fall before the endpoint. And here I have a very exaggerated example where you have contribution from three different neutrinos, and you can expand this sum here for small masses, and you can conclude that this is more or less equivalent to having one spectrum with an effective mass, which is given by this sum here of the matrix element square, the mass square of each of the three neutrinos. This is what is plotted in green here. So this is gives a rough approximation to the exact result. And so this is the quantity that can be constrained by looking at the endpoint in the beta spectrum. More realistically, well, this is was very exaggerated. Values of masses about 5-10% of the Q value. Q value is the maximum energy you can have. In reality, these masses are much smaller than the Q value. For instance, for tritium, Q value is 17 kV, and the masses are below the electron volt. And so you need to look, you have the spectrum there, and you have to look to this tiny part and see the departure from one part in 10 to the 13, for instance, for one electron volt mass. So this is a very difficult experiment. The best experiment which is running now is scattering. This is a detector when it was being moved to Karlsruhe. And this one will be sensitive to a mass of about 0.2 electron volts. At present, it started last year. At present, the best bound came from the previous experiment, which was at Mainz, and it's about 2 electron volts for the mass of the effective mass of the beta decay. And for the other neutrinos, you have bounds which are larger. And already, they are in Catherine is improving on this number in the near future. The other way to look for Majorana masses, this one is sensitive to whatever mass, be it Majorana or Dirac. But if you want to look for a scenario in which neutrinos have Majorana masses, there are some nuclei in which you can have not just one beta decay, but two beta decays at the same time. Generally, you look for nuclei where the single beta decay is forbidden, because the energy of the single beta decay is larger than the original energy, but when you have two beta decays, you can gain energy and you can produce the decay. And so there are 30 nuclei where this can happen, and more than 10 have been observed, where you have two beta decays at the same time. This is just weak interaction, nothing to do with the mass of the neutrino. But if the neutrino has a Majorana mass, it can happen that the neutrino that is emitted in one of the beta decay is absorbed as an antineutrino in the other vertex. And so you have the two electrons emitted, but no neutrino emitted. And this is only possible if the neutrinos have a Majorana mass, because you have to convert the neutrino into antineutrino, if you want. And so this process is proportional to the mass of the neutrino. You can compute, here you have the matrix elements of the E1, E2, E3, now not modulus square, but just square, so you can see also the Majorana phases there. And this is the effective parameter that you can constrain looking at this. And the idea is that you sum the energies of the two electrons, and this will be the distribution from the usual double beta decay with two neutrinos emitted. And then when no neutrinos are emitted, all the energy goes to the two electrons, and you have this peak at the endpoint. And so, at the time being, the constraints are at this level, around 0.1 electron volt, so it's even tighter than the Dirac neutrino, than the tritium beta decay experiment. But, and the leader now is Kamlan Sen, which is using xenon, and there are many other nuclei which are being used by other experiments. And these are the predictions you expect once you take into account all the different things we know about neutrinos, that the prediction should be in this range. So it's already very constraining, and with a slight improvement, it will cover this inverse hierarchy prediction, which I will discuss later. So now to neutrino oscillations. If neutrinos are massive, favorable states are not the same as massing states, so in a weak decay, you produce, say, in every decay, you produce an electron and a neutrino of the electron type. This neutrino will be a mixture of mass eigenstates. Each mass eigenstate we propagate in a different way because the oscillation of the wave function depends on the mass of the neutrino. And so at the end, when you detect, it will be in a different mixture as the original neutrino. It will no longer be pure electron neutrino, it will be a mixture of muon and tau and electron neutrinos. So this you can, the idea is that when you produce a given neutrino with a given flavor, say a muon, then at the end you will detect the neutrino producing an electron or another thing. This will be a signature of neutrino oscillations. And you can obtain the expression for the probability of going from one flavor to the other in a simple way, just saying that the phase that the neutrino of a given mass acquired goes like this. Phase factor, Px minus EIT. If you assume that the momenta of all the neutrinos are the same, the mass eigenstates are the same, you just get the difference in the energies here. And when you project this state at time t into a given flavor, you end up with this expression that you can obtain easily, that tells you that there is an oscillation which depends on delta m squared over 4e. So if you want the oscillation length is E over delta M square. And there is a part which is CP violating, which includes the imaginary part of this product of mixing matrices and the sign without the square of the difference of the phases. This deduction is very simple because I am assuming that all the momenta are the same and the energies are changed in this way. There is no real reason for this to be true. People have discussed this a lot in the past. You can start from the different approach that all the energies are the same and the momenta are different. You get the same result. You can do it better. You can put wave packets and consider that energy and momenta are not well defined. And you do all the computation and you get the same result. So this is very easy to deduce, but the result is correct, even if the procedure is not very formally rigorous. So if you just consider two families, so mixing very simple just by mixing angle, and one mass difference between two eigenstates, this is relevant for the neutrino oscillation in the sun, for the atmospheric neutrinos in some approximations. What you end up is that this long expression here, there is no CP violation, this goes to zero, only this remains, and by two matrix is very simple. And you end up with this expression here, where you can see that the probability is oscillating with time. The probability, if you produce a new alpha to get a new beta different from the original one, it's increasing up to a maximum value of sine squared to theta. And then the oscillation length, the distance here, is given here. So you can see that, for instance, if you take solar neutrinos which have MeV energies, the mass square difference we know today is of the order of 7 times to the minus 5 EV squared. You put this here, you conclude that the oscillation length is like 40 kilometers for a neutrino from the sun. So you have a quantum effect happening on distances of 40 kilometers. If you take the atmospheric neutrinos where the energies are GeVs and the mass square difference is around 2 times to the minus 3, you have the oscillation length is 1,000 kilometers. So again, an oscillation, quantum effect happening at 1,000 kilometers, macroscopic. So by doing many experiments around the last 20, 30 years, we have arrived to the following picture that there are three neutrino mass eigenstates. The lightest one, the new one, is the one with the largest electron component. This in blue is the electron component. In red, you have the muon component, and this is the tau component. This will be UE1 squared, UE2 squared, these numbers here. The second one is split by delta m squared to 1, which is positive and equal to this number here. This came mostly from the solar and reactor neutrinos. And then you have a big mass splitting, bigger mass splitting, 2 times to the minus 3 EV squared. with the third eigen state, which is essentially a mixture of nu mu and nu tau with a small component, this theta 1,3 appearing here of electron type. We still don't know the sign of this mass square difference. This is called the ordering. Some people call it the hierarchy. I prefer the ordering because it's not necessary that the masses are hierarchical. They could be more or less similar. So some people now prefer to call it ordering. And it could be that this is positive or that it is negative. If this were negative, we'll be in this situation where the two neutrinos with the small splitting are the heaviest one, and this is the lighter one. We also don't know what is the mass of the lightest one, the scale. We don't know. We know the mass square differences from oscillation, but not the scale of the masses. We don't know also if this state has more nu mu than nu tau, or vice versa. This is called the octant of theta 2,3. If theta 2,3 is bigger than 45 or less than 45. And we don't know the CP violation. We have some hints on the Dirac CP violation phase, but we have no hints on the other ones. And so this is more or less the picture we have today. If you consider the expression for the three flavor oscillation, in vacuum always, you get this expression here. And you can plot this using these values I mentioned before. And for instance, for the nu e survival, so this is the probability that nu e remains nu e after propagation. It has these oscillations. It has a steep minimum here associated to the 1,2 mixing. So the bigger it is, sine squared to theta 1,2, the more profound will be this minimum. Then you have a small oscillation here with amplitude sine squared theta 2,1,3. And the oscillation frequencies depend on the masses 3,1 and 2,1 squared. And for the nu mu survival, you have a similar plot. Now it's, this is L over E, and this is E over L, so it's reverse because this is more studied in accelerators. It's better to plot it like that. And this has to do with theta 2,3, so this is almost complete conversion. And this frequency has to do with the 3,2 mass square difference. And this has been studied looking at a few, say, 100 kilometers or so of antineutrinos from reactors. They were able to see this oscillation. And this oscillation here was studied with detectors at 1 kilometer from a reactor, like CHUS, double CHUS, or Diabay. Rino. So this is the example of the Kamlan experiment that was made in the Kamioka mine, where the Kamiokande detector is, but this is a scintillator detector, which was able to measure the flux from all the reactors around Japan, which are all more or less between 150 to 250 kilometers. Kamlan is in the center and the reactors are in the coast. And so they were able to study this oscillation here. And essentially, what they got is that in the absence of oscillation, they expect to be this kind of flux. And what they measure is this one. So a strong suppression that will correspond to a measurement around this point in the previous plot of the suppression versus the distance. And in the this is shown as delta m square versus tangent square theta here, the mixing angle. And what Kamlan concluded is that the mass square had to be just in this value to explain this experiment. And by the way, this is the result from solar experiment that we will discuss in the next lecture. And also, if you plot the rates measured as a function of L over E, you can see oscillation, really. You can see two cycles of the oscillation of the probability of survival. Then there were these reactors at closer distance from the reactor that can study this oscillation. And depending on the value of theta 1,3, you will get more or less suppressions. This has to do with mass square difference 3,1, but this has to do with the mixing theta 1,3. And there were these three experiments, Diabay, double CHUS, and Rino. And you have here the results on the Theta-1-3 values, which are essentially dominated by Daya Bay and Reno, and give you this value, which corresponds more or less to 8 degrees for Theta-1-3. Then, in the future, there may be even bigger. These were scintillators like Juno, is a proposal to put, is a detector that is being built in China near these two big reactors that could make precision with, here the baseline is larger, it's 50 kilometers, but you could in principle measure very good accuracy the oscillations and get very good measurements of the mixing angles and mass square differences. And you may eventually be also able to see some difference between the two hierarchies, the inverse and the normal hierarchy, because the oscillation frequency is different from the two. Essentially, if you want delta m squared 3-1, which is the relevant one for these oscillations, is the one delta m squared 3-2, which is related to the atmospheric neutrinos, and differs in this plus or minus this quantity depending on the hierarchy, and so you can try to measure this small difference by being able to distinguish between the red and the blue patterns there. And then there are long baseline experiments where you take more energetic neutrinos, not from reactors but from accelerators, and you send them from, for instance, from Keck to Kamioka, 250 kilometers, or from Fermilab to Sudan, a Minos experiment. This, if you want, and then there was one from CERN to Gran Sasso. And at present, we have these two experiments, NOVA going to Ash River, which is a bit farther from Minos, and T2K is a little bit also larger than K2K. And these are those leading now the searches for determination of CP violation and many things in the neutrino sector. And in the future, there will be this beam from Fermilab to Homestake, 1,300 kilometers, which you will hear a lot in this conference in several talks. And then Hyper-K will appear instead of Super-K, and this will be also quite an improvement. And with this experiment, you can study this. This was the new mu survival probability I showed before. And you can study theta 2-3, you can study the mass square differences, and you can also study the hierarchy and the CP violation. For instance, these are predictions for different orderings, invert ordering and normal ordering. And this has to do with the fact that neutrinos go through the Earth, and there are interactions with the Earth that affect the oscillations. I will talk about this in the next lecture, but just let me mention. And also, depending on CP violation, you will have different predictions. Another important thing of the experiment is that it's better to have a narrow distribution of the energy of the neutrinos to be more precise. If you put your detector just in front of the beam, the distribution will be like that, of the neutrino energies. If you put your detector a bit off of the beam, by, in this case, 2 degrees of axis, the distribution of neutrinos will be narrower. So you will get less neutrinos, but with a better determination of their energy. So these experiments tend to be off-axis to improve on this. And these are the results, for instance, of K2K. They had these neutrino energies, and they expected to see something like that, and they saw something like this. And these are the predictions from oscillations. And this is much better in Minos, where you have more statistics and better measurements. And you can see that if you make the ratio between the expected and observed and expected muon survival, you get this picture here. And you can determine very well the mixing and the mass difference. And then there is what is another thing that is useful is that compare use muon neutrino beams and anti neutrino beams also, and compare the oscillation in the neutrino and the antineutrino channel. And so this will give you a hint of CP violation. If you see a difference, the way neutrinos oscillates and antineutrinos oscillates, this comes from CP violation. Besides the CP violation in the mixing matrix, also the Earth violates CP if you want, because in the Earth you have electrons but you don't have positrons. And so this is a plot showing you how, as a function of the CP violation phase, you will expect this ratio of nu mu, anti nu mu to nu e appearance to the sum will behave. And this will be for normal high energy and for inverted high energy and ignoring matter effects. And so you see that there is a mixture of matter effects, CP violation, everything that makes analysis a bit complicated, but you can do that. And this is, for instance, NOAA, this experiment from Fermilab to Minnesota, where you have here an oscillated prediction for nu mu disappearance, and this is what they observed. And then also they had new appearances that I don't have the histogram, but you have here the result that this is the total number of events of appearance is in this range here, and this is what the prediction will be as a function of delta CP for the normal and inverted hierarchy. So you already see that there is some favoring of the normal hierarchy with respect to inverted hierarchy by these kind of measurements. And this plot on the right tells you that this number of events in the antineutrino channel and the neutrino channel depends on many things. And these, for instance, are for inverted and for normal hierarchy, the prediction will be in these blue or red regions. If sine squared theta to 3 is bigger than 0.5 or smaller than 0.5, you will go from there to there. It depends on the octant, and then you move around the ellipses depending on the CP violation on the phase of delta. So you have to measure a point in this plot, and from that to infer the different properties. And when you put the many experiments together, you get this kind of constraints. How am I in time? I'm bad. Okay, I'm almost. You can constrain delta m squared 3, 2, and 2, 3 for the mixing angle. This is from NOAA and from T2K. These are the most constraining ones. This other one came from Minos. It was bigger one, older experiment. And this comes from studies of atmospheric neutrinos that I will discuss in the next talks, which are all consistent. And they are shrinking with time, and but you see, we still don't know the quadrant, the octant, if it is there or there. And now there are evidence at the level of 3 sigma in favor of the normal hierarchy, the normal ordering. And so one can constrain all this mixing in the different sectors, 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 3, using different experiments from solar and reactors, from reactors at short distances, from Lost Wavelength Accelerator, and from atmospheric neutrinos, and you get this kind of best fit values of the parameters. There is an industry on that. Many groups are computing every year and updating their constraints on the values of the parameters. This is taken from NuFIT. You can find there are others. And the conclusion is that you have all these best fit values, and the chi-squares are minimizing these values that are reported in the table, but you see that normal ordering is in red, inverted ordering is in blue, and the blue chi-square is always 2.5 or 3 sigma, depending on the things you take above the normal ordering. One picture that comes out from this is that the mixing in the lepton sector is very different from the mixing in the quark sector. In the quark sector, I told you, it was just one in the diagonal, the Cavivo angle here, and the rest was tiny. In the lepton sector, you have maximal mixing in 2-3 sector, a large mixing in the 1-2 sector. Theta 1-3 is not very small either, but you have a different picture. So physics is different in the quarks and in the lepton. Well, this is more or less this is a slide showing the progress with respect on the determination of the hierarchy. And this is what I show from NOVA, is now at the 2 sigma level, and we are here. There are chances of making improvements studying atmospheric neutrinos in Ice Cube or in the upgrade of Antares, which is Orca, in the Mediterranean, that may reach the even the 5 sigma level. This Juno detector also, well, I know in India it's probably shifted in the future. I don't know where. They don't know either, I think. And Jung will appear and will be able to do clear determination. Once you know the hierarchy, it's just one sign. So it's a problem that you get rid of. All the analysis will become simpler. but I will bet now that the normal hierarchy is in a good track. And Jung will do these things with a very improved sensitivity to many things, because they will be able to see the tracks of the particles, and you will hear in the next 2 talks a lot about this. And finally, regarding neutrino masses, a very strong constraint comes from cosmology, because you know the universe has dark energy, dark matter, and normal matter, and if you look at the baryonic matter here, what is not in gas, stars make this part here, and then there are also neutrinos, which are nothing to do with baryons, but we contribute actually comparable to the stars in the universe. So the contribution of neutrinos is of the order of 3 × 10⁻³ for a sum of the masses of 150 MeV, millielectron volt. And so this has an effect on the way the structure forming the universe, and now we have bound from large structure which are at the level of, say, less than 0.2, 0.1 millielectron volt, depending on how many measurements you take into account. So this is, if you want, the strongest constraint on the neutrino masses we have nowadays. And with this, I'm done.
Questions?
Yeah.